Mr. Ambassador, thank you very much for your time. David Cameron said that the UN Assembly, that the UK is willing to bring Afghanistan and Pakistan together to solve their shared problems. Recently, President Karzai just accused Pakistan that it's behind the attacks on Afghanistan intelligence chief. So how does it make your job difficult?
Well, I think that given the history of your relationship with Pakistan, it was never going to be a quick or straightforward process to help the two countries to come together and feel a sense of shared purpose and collaboration. But if you look at the last few months, I think there has been real progress. The High Peace Council visit to Pakistan, Foreign Minister Rasool's visit, General Kayani coming here, and last week Dr. Rasool and Hina Rabbanikar, the Pakistani Foreign Minister, were in London for a joint meeting with William Hague, our Foreign Minister. And these have all, I think, been productive and quite warm meetings in which there's been a real sense of shared purpose and honesty about the difficulties that remain. Obviously, the attack on Azadullah Khalid has been a setback and a tragic development. But I think that what President Karzai has said is that he believes that the attackers came from Pakistan, not that the government of Pakistan was behind the attack. And he's said that he wants to get a proper investigation to establish the facts, which seems to be entirely right. And today he is flying, as you know, to Turkey for a meeting with President Zardari and the Turkish Prime Minister. And so that there is a sense that the talking continues despite the continuing difficulties in the relationship.
Mr. Ambassador, you look optimistic that the Pakistan has changed its strategy towards Afghanistan. What's make you believe on it?
Well, I think that I don't want to sound over-optimistic, but there's evidence that the government of Pakistan is engaging much more constructively and actively with Afghanistan. I think General Kayani's visit here was quite symbolic because he is a very powerful figure in Pakistan, and I think he had some very good meetings with President Karzai and other senior figures in the Afghan government. I think that if you look at the progress on prisoner releases, which is a long-standing request of Afghanistan, it's now begun to happen. I understand that the cross-border shelling, which is a big issue, the signs that has been reduced. There's a commitment to have a meeting between the ulama of Afghanistan and Pakistan in the next few months to try and address the religious context of radicalism, as you might describe it. So I wouldn't want to claim it's all resolved and sorted, but I think there is genuine progress.
What has been changed? What's changed? Why Pakistan, during the last 10 years, was not that much productive that right now you think it is?
Well, I wouldn't want to claim we know exactly what's driving the thinking of the Pakistani government, but I think they can see the damage which would be caused to Pakistan if there were some sort of political collapse in Afghanistan after 2014. And they, I think, see a need to protect themselves against that by trying to reduce its likelihood. So they can see a danger that the threats which you currently see coming across the border from Pakistan into Afghanistan, I think they can see a future in it, which it might be the opposite way around, and are trying to devise a strategy to make that risk less likely for them.
There are some reports which would suggest that the both civilian and military government in Pakistan realized that Taliban have been like a liability for the government during the last 10 years. Yeah. Do you think this is the reality or it's right?
Well, I think that there is a degree to which they are a burden and a complication. It's clearly complicated their relationship with the outside world, not just with Afghanistan, but with Britain, the United States and others, having these groups based inside Pakistan. So I think it has been a liability to some degree. And I think it's very encouraging that they are now asking the Taliban to negotiate with the government of Afghanistan a long-time peaceful settlement here, asking them to break from Al-Qaeda, both in practice and publicly. So I think they have changed their view of the sort of the balance of advantage and can see much more clearly now the drawbacks of having these people based inside Pakistan and the reality that the Taliban, whether the Pakistani Taliban or the Afghan Taliban, are very difficult in practice to separate, and they both represent a threat to both countries.
But some people think still that the Pakistani Taliban and the Afghan Taliban are the same, and somehow the Pakistani establishment use both these groups to destabilize Afghanistan. So do you think this is the case?
I think we think that the Pakistani Taliban is seen by the government of Pakistan as a threat to Pakistan, and I think that's one of the reasons that they've become more enthusiastic about talking to Afghanistan is because they want to try to deal with a threat to themselves. So they can see that the Pakistani Taliban are undertaking actions in Pakistan which are very contrary to their interests. And I would argue that in practice, the two Taliban groups are not that distinct. Their ideology is very similar. And the fact that they're focused on slightly different immediate targets does not reduce the danger they pose both to Afghanistan and to Pakistan in the medium term. And we think that analysis is much more common now in Pakistan than it was 3 or 4 years ago.
But, Mr. Ambassador, do you think that support during the last 10 years from the Pakistani governments to the Afghan Taliban caused them to lose the war of perception in Afghanistan, that now most Afghans think that they are somehow behind the insurgency in Afghanistan, yeah. And now the anti-Pakistani sentiment in Afghanistan is very high.
It is very striking to me as a relative newcomer to Afghanistan that Pakistan, which 20 years ago perhaps was seen as a benefactor, which had taken in large numbers of refugees and helped Afghanistan during the period of the Soviet occupation, is now viewed so negatively by so many people here. So I think your analysis is correct that by supporting the Taliban, they have generated a good deal of hostility in public opinion in Afghanistan. But just as I think they went from being a force for good in the eyes of most Afghans to the opposite, I think it's perfectly possible over time for that perception to switch back to the more positive one which people had here in the 80s and very early 90s.
But, Mr. Ambassador, from the international community viewpoint, how do you see Pakistan? It's a part of the problem or part of the solution now?
Well, I don't know if it's in one clear box or the other. I think that it's probably got problems inside it which need to be solved, and internationally it's important that they are solved for all of us, for Pakistan, for Afghanistan and for us. And so I think that we would argue that Pakistan needs to address the problems which it faces domestically, and we believe increasingly that is the view of the Pakistani political establishment, that they do see the risks that these groups pose to their society as well as outside and want to find a way to manage it. But obviously, changing a society that has gone in one direction for a period is a difficult process and probably quite a slow process.
Mr. Ambassador, you have been in India. You worked there as a UK High Commissioner. So how do you see there's a tension between the Islamabad and Delhi as well. So can Delhi replace Pakistan for Afghanistan? And how do you see that?
I think Afghanistan is going to have to live with its own geography. I can see why you might want to change some of your neighbours, or possibly the whole lot of your neighbours, and find some new ones. But you've got the neighbours you have, and if Afghanistan is going to flourish, it needs to collaborate and cooperate with your neighbours. And in the case of Pakistan, Pakistan is the route to India. If you're going to trade with India, have more people-to-people contacts and so on, that having routes through Pakistan is going to be critical. So I think that the challenge is to persuade Pakistan that they should facilitate and encourage these links, and that you should, in a sense, begin to do what happened in Europe after the Second World War, of using economic benefits and interdependence to help facilitate the resolution of political problems.
But, Mr. Ambassador, do you think that the Pakistan concern over the influence of India in Afghanistan is legitimate?
I think that both India and Pakistan view Afghanistan too much through the prism of their own bilateral relationship between Delhi and Islamabad, and both occasionally see shadows and ghosts which don't really exist. I think that the answer has to be...
Do you see the type of proxy wars here? Do you suggest that?
I think that's greatly exaggerated. I think that both sides have more suspicion of the other than is probably justified by their actions. And I think in the context of the overall Delhi-Islamabad relationship, they need to come to terms with the fact that they both have legitimate interests in Afghanistan as an important neighbour of both, and they need to be honest with each other about the way they're pursuing these.
Mr. Ambassador, the other issue is the issue of 2014 and beyond that. Yeah. The perception among the Afghan about towards 2014 is a negative. President Karzai always mentioned that the international community, somehow he blamed that they are beyond that negative perception. But what's your viewpoints about that, and how do you see 2014?
I think 2014 is a year which people are focusing on, understandably, because it's the year when you'll have the transition from President Karzai to his successor, the first change of leader in modern Afghanistan. It's the year when the ISAF mandate ends and the bulk of foreign troops will leave. So I think it's not surprising that people are viewing this with a degree of concern. What I think people forget is that we've made international commitments to continue very large-scale support to Afghanistan after 2014, equivalent roughly to 50%, half of the current Afghan economy will be added to Afghanistan's wealth by money from overseas. That's a very big, very material, very real contribution to Afghanistan's stability.
From your viewpoint, Mr. Ambassador, how can we fix that before 2014 that the international troops will leave Afghanistan? And how can we create a type of hope and change that perception?
It's a very good and very important question. I mean, I think we need to be get a better message across about the effectiveness of your armed forces. I mean, in Helmand, in the canal zone of Nariali, where a year ago we had 5 companies of British troops, today we have 1 company, and security is as good as ever, so that the Afghan army is taking on its role and doing so very effectively. I think that's not appreciated as much as it should be in Afghanistan in general. There's an assumption that too much is resting on the foreign troops, when in reality the transition is happening before our eyes, and 75% of the population are now in areas where the Afghan National Army leads the security agenda. So that has, I think, changed, but people haven't really realized it. I think that we need to make clear that our financial commitments are going to continue, so we will be helping to ensure that public services, healthcare, education and so on can continue, broadly speaking, as they have done in the last decade. So I think there's a pretty positive message if we could just get it across.
But do you think, Mr. Ambassador, do you need the international community and the UK to make a military commitment beyond 2014, beside the commitment that you already have been made in terms of the economic support?
Exactly. Well, we've made a commitment to support the Afghan National Security Forces through supporting their finances by putting in $110 million a year to contribute to their paying their salaries and so on. So we're demonstrating support for them in that way. I think it is important, this is my personal view, that there should be an international presence, almost certainly US-led, after 2014, as much as anything else to provide reassurance and confidence to people in Afghanistan, not because I feel that the Afghan army can't survive by itself, but because that would be a demonstration of our continuing engagement, which I think would give added encouragement and confidence to people in Afghanistan. And I think confidence is a very, very important. And another area where we are trying to help is by offering scholarships for Afghans to come to the UK. It's called the Chevening Scholarship Scheme. It's open until the 2nd of January 2013 for the forthcoming year. And we very much hope that, as in the past, we'll get a very high-caliber group of Afghan students with high academic qualifications wanting to come to the UK, study with us, and then come back and contribute to your country's future successful development.
Beyond 2014, the US and international forces will still conduct operation against the insurgent groups.
They're going to have to reach a negotiation with the president on the terms on which any of us stay. I think that the principal purpose would be to offer support to the Afghan forces in...
What's the UK stance on it? You think, Mr. Ambassador, still it's needed?
Yeah. We think that a continuation of support for some of the forces, particularly maybe some of your special army and special police units, would be good because they are very critical to your ability to deal with some of the major threats that Afghanistan faces. But increasingly, we're very confident about their capability to operate on their own. And I say, in part, I think it's a psychological message to reassure them that we're still here, but also to reassure the people of Afghanistan that the international community is, in a sort of physical and tangible way, not leaving, whereas the money is a rather invisible support, critical, but not one that the average person maybe is very conscious of, whereas a presence of thousands of troops in the country is a very real manifestation of our continued commitment.
Yeah. Mr. Ambassador, most of Afghan think that the beyond 2014, it's like international troops leaving Afghanistan. So the end of, it's mean the end of war. 2014 is the end of war for NATO. So Afghan think that it's now the beginning of the war for Afghans. So do you think it's the case?
No, I mean, Afghans are fighting every day at the moment in the war against insurgency. And in fact, I think there's an exaggeration about the importance of the end of 2014. In practice, it's going to be a milestone on a road which began in 2001 and will carry on to the end of the transformation decade, as it's described by the president and Ashraf Ghani. So we will continue to be here. Our development support is already committed to 2017, so that's 5 years from now. We've made a formal public commitment to our parliament to continue our support. So for us, it's not a sudden change of direction. It is an evolution from one sort of relationship to another, the other being one in which there is much greater autonomy and independence on the Afghan side, but with continuing support, both financial and material, from the UK, the US, and others.
Mr. Ambassador, I want to understand about your viewpoint about the... there are a lot of discussions in Afghanistan about the presence of the foreign troops in Afghanistan. Yeah. Do you think somehow, even President Karzai also talked about that, that the issue related between the sovereignty of Afghanistan and then the presence of the international troops, beyond 2014, how do you see that? And how can we address that issue?
Well, I mean, it's a difficult question for me as a foreigner to really comment on how Afghanistan sees these issues. We have had US bases in Britain since the Second World War and have not found that a great problem. We had British bases in Germany and still do throughout the period since 1945. And so for us, the idea of your allies and friends having military bases in your country is not unusual, it's not threatening, it's not a worry. So we would see it from our perspective that Afghanistan would agree with some of its current allies to continue a military relationship beyond 2014 because it was perceived to be in the interests of both parties, so that it would help, for example, the US in the war on terror, but it would also help Afghanistan to ensure that its forces were well supported in dealing with any future insurgencies inside Afghanistan.
Mr. Ambassador, how can Afghan government convince its neighboring countries, especially Pakistan, Iran, and then somehow Russia, which they already have some issues or concern over the presence of foreign troops beyond 2014 in Afghanistan?
Well, that's a question as much for the Afghan government as for me, but I think that they need to make clear that these are here not to support some action hostile to these neighbors, but to help the government of Afghanistan protect itself against what are still very visible threats to your national security and the stability of your country. And I think that if the presence is positioned very clearly in terms of its role being to support the Afghan National Army in preventing insurgency and dealing with it inside Afghanistan, that should give great reassurance to all of your neighbours and give them a clear sense that the purpose of this force is clearly defined and limited.
UK wants to have counter-terrorism forces beyond 2014 in Afghanistan, or it will be only US forces?
Yeah, I think that we will have a role in three areas probably after 2014, though I say this is none of this has been agreed or negotiated with your government, right. So I'm giving you a broad picture of how we see it. First of all, that we will be part of a NATO operation providing training, assistance and advice to the Afghan National Army. Secondly, we will be providing quite a lot of support to a new officer academy training the future leaders of the Afghan National Army, and we believe leadership in the armed forces is a critical area where we can help. And I think we will probably still hear in some form to continue mentoring the special forces, the special police and army units which we currently support through mentoring, and I think that will continue. But I say all three of these things are dependent on the government of Afghanistan wanting them to happen.
Are you still negotiating these issues, or you think that was part of the strategic partnership deal with the British, which was signed?
The officer academy is essentially agreed. When David Cameron was here in July, he and the president signed a memorandum of understanding on setting this up. There is, as ever, detail to be resolved beneath that commitment. The NATO presence is one that's going to be negotiated between NATO and the government of Afghanistan and will depend upon what your government wants, what support they're looking for. The role of our special forces, I think, will fall out of the negotiations of the bilateral security agreement with the US.
Yeah. Mr. Ambassador, the other issue is the issue of corruption in Afghanistan. How damaging is the blame game on who is behind the corruption here in Afghanistan? Afghan government or the international community?
I think that the international community should admit that over the last 10 years we have put a lot of money into Afghanistan. Not all of it has been spent very carefully or very sensibly. So we have undoubtedly, in some areas, contributed to the development of corruption in the economy.
But you blame for that the Afghan government, or you think the blame is going to the...
I think in some cases we should take some of the blame ourselves as having not spent our own money in a very sensible way. But overall, addressing the problem of corruption is an issue for the government of Afghanistan. It's about setting up the right procedures, the right systems, the right controls to ensure that the use of public money is transparent and that people can see that the taxes they pay, the services they pay for, are being delivered in a way which minimizes the risk of corrupt practices in the process.
But Mr. Ambassador, do you think this is the time to push harder the Afghan government to fight the corruption, because Afghanistan is now the most corrupt country on the face of earth?
Well, we do think it's a very important issue. We raise it very regularly with the government. We want them to take very firm action on the Kabul Bank, which is a very visible symbol of the problem. And we want them to give a high priority to creating systems in government which make corruption less likely and more difficult. Nowhere in the world can you probably eliminate it 100%, but you can do a lot more to limit this really quite serious risk to your economy and your society than has yet been done. And so I think that the government does need to give a higher priority to this on its own very busy agenda. I mean, they have a lot to deal with. They've got elections coming, they've got the security issues, they've got their relationship with their neighbours. But from our point of view, corruption is a cancer in society. Unless you deal with it, it will gradually spread.
Do you think, Mr. Ambassador, that the fighting corruption would be the condition for providing support to Afghanistan?
I think that over the period of years, the assistance will become less and less generous if people believe that the money is not going to the purpose for which it's intended. So that there is a link. It is a link which is driven as much by public opinion and parliaments as by governments. But this money is not invented, it doesn't grow on trees. This is money paid for by, in my case, British taxpayers. and they rightly want to know where the money is going to. And if they gradually conclude it's not being spent sensibly, it's not achieving the goals for which it's intended, they will tell the government, please stop spending it.
Yeah, well, so what type of pressure right now you face in your own country since the Afghanistan become the most corrupt country?
At the moment, the focus of public interest in Britain is largely on the security environment. We've got between 9 and 10,000 troops in this country. They have a very visible presence in Helmand, and that is where the focus of media attention, parliamentary attention, public attention tends to be. As that changes, I think the focus will also change and people become more and more conscious of and concerned about where these substantial sums of money are going and whether they're having the desired effect, the effect desired by both the British government and the Afghan government.
Mr. Ambassador, the other issue is, the most important issue is the election 2014. So how do you see that? What type of obstacles do you think that the Afghan government and Afghan people will face during that election?
Well, I agree with you. It is very important, possibly the most important event of the next few years in Afghanistan. From our point of view, there are sort of two perspectives. One is, the most important one is the Afghan perspective, where it's very important that there is an election and a transition from President Karzai to his successor, which is accepted by the people of Afghanistan as being a legitimate process and one in which those who lose accept the result. They say that they regret losing, but they accept that that's a legitimate decision by the people of Afghanistan. And that's very important. It's also important from the outside because we've been engaged in Afghanistan for over a decade already, and by 2014 it'll be 12 years. And for the people of Britain, it will be one of the benchmarks of whether this engagement has been a useful and productive exercise for Afghanistan and for the UK. And a good election, which people say, that shows the people of Afghanistan are having the right to choose their leaders and are doing so in a transparent and effective way, would be a hugely positive signal in my country.
Yeah. Sir Ambassador, what are your expectations? That election would be more in urban areas based, or you think the Afghan government would be able to manage it to go through the villages or even rural areas?
Yes. Well, it's difficult to predict today quite what things will be like in April 2014, but our expectation is that there will be a possibility for a very large percentage of the population to vote legitimately on the day, and we believe a large turnout is a very important signal of success. And while in some parts of the country people tell me that it's more difficult now than it was in 2009, certainly in Helmand, which I know best outside Kabul, it is far, far better now. It's far easier to imagine a successful election in Helmand in 2014 than it ever would have been in 2009. So we approach this with a reasonable amount of confidence that it can be done successfully, but it will require the government to develop a full plan, working with the IEC as to how the election will be organised, how it will be managed, how to ensure there is a high turnout. That turnout is across the country, not just in pockets, as you say, not just in the urban pockets. But we believe that it isn't impossibly difficult to achieve this goal. You know, there's a country where 71% of the people have access to a mobile phone. It shouldn't be that impossible to get them access to a polling station.
Yeah, Mr. Ambassador, the Afghan people want to know that is the 2014 election is priority for the international community?
Yes, it's a very high priority for us. It's an issue which we think is central to our relationship with Afghanistan. In the agreement at Tokyo on our future funding of Afghanistan, we agreed that having good elections was a very important indicator of success, both for Afghanistan as a country and for the international community as your partners, and that remains the case.
Yeah. What type of reaction the international community will have in case of any delay in the election time, especially if even the Afghan government have some logistic issues?
Well, we are not the guardians of your constitution. I'm told that to meet the constitution, the election needs to be in April 2014 in order to allow the new president to take over from the current president in May. I mean, from our point of view, it's much more important that the election happens in a way which the people of Afghanistan are able to vote freely and fairly, and that they can actually feel at the end of the day they've legitimately expressed their views and been able to choose their new leader.
Even if there is delay. So.
I mean, from our point of view, we are not going to involve ourselves in a great battle. If the parties involved, you know, the Charter for Democracy parties, the president and others, say, actually, because of the weather or geography or whatever, it would be more sensible to have the election 1 month or 2 months later than the current plan, that for the United Kingdom would not be a show-stopping issue. Again, it's not for us to interfere, but as long as it's an outcome which, broadly speaking, people in the political classes accept is a reasonable decision, we would entirely go along with it.
Yeah. The issue of the have a fair and free election is the most important thing for the Afghan people, because the election 2009, we had a lot of accusations that even people, most of Afghans think that there were a lot of difficulty conducting the 2009 election. So how is it important for the international community that the election should be inclusive, fair and free?
Yeah, we want the best possible election, which includes all the elements you've described. It includes, I say, a high turnout across the country, the ability of people from different ethnic groups, men and women, to have a full chance to vote. And it involves the process being monitored principally by Afghan organizations, whether it's the Independent Election Commission or civil society, in a way which, at the end of it, the people of Afghanistan feel that they have participated in a process which has been legitimate and which has led to the election of a credible and appropriate new leader of their country.
Mr. Ambassador, as in the last questions, President Karzai raised the issue, I think, over the prisons, the transfer of the Afghan prisoners,
yep.
Prisoners from the American jails to Afghans. And even President Karzai mentioned that it's the issue of sovereignty for Afghanistan.
Yep.
So what's your viewpoint in the UK viewpoints on that?
Yes, we, as you probably know, we have some detainees who we have captured on the battlefield over the last few months, and we want to transfer those detainees to the Afghan authorities for prosecution. We've worked quite closely with the NDS to develop detailed cases against all but a few of them, and believe that this should happen as soon as we can find a route to do so which our courts in the UK are happy with. Unfortunately, our courts have been involved in a very long process of examining our approach to detentions, the British approach, and they are not happy with some of the things that we've been doing.
But, Mr. Ambassador, your defense minister mentioned that it's not the case that they will not transfer these detainees to the Afghan government.
No, we will. We are very keen to do so as soon as possible, but we have to do so in a way which our courts, the British courts, are happy with. So they take the view that for as long as the British government is detaining people, the British courts have a degree of oversight over this, and they are insisting that we can only transfer detainees in particular ways which will be acceptable legally in their eyes. And so we're trying to find a way with the government of Afghanistan to allow that to happen, so these detainees can leave our detention, where we don't want them, and move to Afghan custody for prosecution, where the Afghan authorities do want them. And it is a process of just trying to find a route from where we are now to where we want to be. But in this case, both we and the Afghan authorities are agreed about the destination. What we haven't yet discovered in the last few months is the best route to move these detainees. You know, which institution should we move them to? Is the UK court system content? And we're just trying to work that out at the moment. And I hope in months, if not weeks, we can find a way to do that.
Mr. Ambassador, thank you very much for your time.